All right. So today we are going to look at circuit theorems. We would call them network theorems. It's one and the same thing. So these theorems are basically used to also make calculations of quantities in circuits where we have more than one source. So we'll start with the superposition theorem. So superposition in English, if you are superimposed, it means you are putting something on top of an already existing component. So the superposition theorem is used when we have two or more sources that are neither in parallel nor in series. Remember, we said you can only connect voltage sources in parallel if they have the same voltage rating, and you can only connect current sources in series if they have the same current rating. Otherwise, there will be no straightforward way of connecting those in series. So the superposition theorem, it states that the current through or the voltage across an element in a network is equal to the algebraic sum of current or voltages produced independently by each source. So what we are saying is, if you consider a component, the overall current flowing through it is a result of the different contributions that the different sources are giving to that component. Let's take, for example, it's a simple thing, okay? Let's say a bag of oranges in which some people are taking oranges and others are eating oranges, right? So what happens? The number of oranges left in the bag are basically a result of the number of oranges that people are eating and the number of oranges that people are subtracting from the bag. So that's the superposition theorem. So you realize that in components, some components will push current, let's say in the upward direction, others will push current in the downward direction, and the overall effect will be the difference between the two. So what we are saying is that quantity on a component depends on the overall effect produced by each source if it was acting independently, right? So if we know that we have to find the effect of an independent source, what it means is that we should have a way of analyzing the effect of a single component. Right? So the total power now that should be delivered to a resistive component will now be given by the total current or voltage across that component, and cannot be determined by a simple sum of power levels established by its source. So this effect of contributive result of sources only comes when we are considering voltage and current. When we consider power now, we have to consider the overall effect on the component and use the overall effect to calculate the power, right? Why? Because a resistive element will always be heated up. So when the current is flowing upwards or downwards, the element will always heat up. So you cannot use the additive components of the power. So power, you have to establish the effect of all sources, then you use the overall value to calculate power. That should be noted. So let's look at that circuit. We assume that V1 and V2 are acting together to produce the current I. Right? If it is V1 and V2 to produce a current I. So what happens? We consider V1 alone and see the current that it produces. Then we consider V2 alone and see the current that it produces. So in that case, V1 is pushing current in the clockwise direction around the loop. V2 is also pushing current I2 in the clockwise direction around the loop. What it means is the overall effect is the sum of I1 and I2. And hence, for each component, the voltage across it will be determined by the sum of the two multiplied by the resistance of that component. This is a very simplistic example. Why? Because you could actually take those sources and connect them in series, add them up first, then you use Ohm's law. But I was just trying to illustrate how superposition theorem can be used in that case. So given the circuit, we want also to demonstrate the solution using superposition theorem. Like again, I've realized that the sources are in series. So it is obvious that you could connect VA, VB, and VC in series since they're in the same loop. Remember, when components are in the same loop, you can change positions without changing the circuit configuration. So what it means is you could actually connect VA, VB, and VC in series, consider their overall effect by their polarities, then go on like that. But we want to use superposition. We want to use superposition theorem. We want to use superposition theorem. So VA acting alone, VA is 10 volts. So if it is acting alone, the current will be 10 divided by 5, which is 2 amps. So the current due to VA is 2 amps in the clockwise direction. The current due to VB is 10 is 5, so 5 by 5 is 1. So the current due to VB will again be 1 amp in the clockwise direction again. Then we consider VC. VC again is pushing current in the clockwise direction, and the current is 3, so the sum is 6 amps. Now someone will ask me, how do we consider that VA is acting alone and VB is acting alone? We will show that in the coming stages. We'll show you how you consider the source independently. But from what I've shown you, you realize that the current is additive. Why? Because the polarities of the sources are pointing in the same direction, right? I hope we are moving in the same direction there. Now with the VA plus VB acting in that situation, VC is equal to 0. It means IA plus B is about 3 amps. Then with VC acting alone, VA plus VB should be equal to 0. And IC is equal to 3. Then we see that superposition will hold for that circuit. Superposition will hold for that kind of circuit. Right? superposition will hold for that kind of circuit. But like I said, these are simplistic examples. You will not find a question of superposition with such a simple setup, okay? But I'm just trying to illustrate to you in an easier way. Now there comes a realistic question which says, find I using superposition. So the first thing that we want to find is that, what is I? I is the current through the 6-ohm resistor. We should bear that in mind. I is the current through the 6-ohm resistor. So how do we find the total current I? We have to find the current due to IS acting alone, then the current due to VS acting alone, right? How do we consider those sources acting alone? The first thing is, we deactivate one source and consider the other. Then you deactivate the other source and consider the other. Now, how do you deactivate? Bear that in mind. That is the very important thing which will make you either succeed or fail in superposition. That will make you either succeed or what? Or fail in superposition. So, to deactivate a current source, you disconnect it totally from the source so that it leaves an open circuit. In other words, to deactivate a current source, you remove it from the circuit and it will leave an open circuit. That is how you deactivate a current source. To deactivate a voltage source, you remove it and replace it with a short circuit. That means you give a 0-ohm resistance path across where the voltage source was. So to deactivate a voltage source, you replace it with a short circuit. You remove the source, then where it was connected, you connect a continuous wire, which is a short circuit. That is the way you deactivate those two. Oh. Then as you are moving, you will now use one source after deactivating the other, then you use another source after deactivating the other source, right? So that's a very, very important thing to take note of. That's a very important thing to take note of. You deactivate one source, you consider the effect of the other alone, you deactivate the next source, consider its effect alone. Right, I'm sure I've explained. So when you are removing a current source, you just remove it and leave an open connection. When you are removing a voltage source, you remove it and replace where it was connected with a short circuit. That is a path of zero resistance. So we want to see the effect of the voltage source. So we have removed the current source and we have left an open circuit. What it now means is that the current that is being pushed by the voltage source no longer goes to that connection because it has no path, so there is no current there. So our I in this path is equal to zero. There's no current there. Our I is equal to zero. Then, when we have this kind of scenario, remember we said the voltage source will push current from the positive into the circuit back through the negative. So in our case, current due to the voltage source is going downwards. Then what is the current? We use Ohm's law. Total resistance is 18 ohms. Source is got 54 volts. So what is the total current? 54 over 18, you get your 3 amps. Is the current contributed by the voltage source and it's going downwards. Then what's next? You remove the voltage source. So the voltage source was between these two points. We removed it and replaced with a continuous connection, which is a 0 volt path, a 0 ohm resistance path, right? Give a 0 ohm resistance path. Not. Then we want to find the current into that source. The current source is pushing current upwards, so it comes and branches into these two portions, of which the current due to the current source is also going downwards with respect to the resistor. Then we use our current divider rule. So if you need current in this path, your formula will be the resistance of the other path, that is 12, over the sum of the two, which is 18, then multiplied by the current from the source, that is 3. Right? It should be 6, sorry. So it becomes 36 over 18, you get your 2 amps going downwards. Then we come back and check. The voltage source was pushing current downwards. The current source is also pushing current downwards, meaning to say the overall current through the 6 ohm is the additive effect, because they are not opposing each other. It's an additive effect because they are not opposing each other. So the effect is additive. So the total current will be current due to the current source and current due to the voltage source. So your total current is 5 amps downwards. Right? I'm sure this example is clear. Let's use again superposition theorem to calculate the voltage across R4. So the first thing that we have to do is to identify R4. R4 is here. So it is 10 ohms. And we want to calculate the voltage across R4. Now, there are many ways of calculating voltage. The first thing is you might find a voltage by seeing if it is in parallel with the source or it is in parallel with any other component for which you can calculate the voltage, right? Now, this example is not very common because if you look at it, you don't see a total complete circuit per se. So there should be a tactic, which I will show you, which helps you to do that calculation. We had said this example when we're doing physical classes. Now that it is virtual, I have to draw the circuit again for you so that I can explain what is happening there. Just bear with me a bit so that I draw the circuit. Then you can see how we simplify that kind of circuit. Right, this is 9 ohms, it's R2. That's 15 ohms, that's R3. And that's R4, where we want to find the voltage. And it's again connected to the ground. Now, let me show you how we deal with this kind of scenario. Let me show you how we deal with this scenario, right? So, I'm sure you see my video now. Right. So this is the circuit which we are talking about. Right, just check it, and it should see that circuit, that the circuit which we are talking about. Right, that's the circuit we are talking about. Now I want to convert that circuit to a usual circuit which you use in your calculations. Want to convert that to an ordinary circuit. So, if a voltage is given as a hanging voltage, for example, the 42 volts, since the plus is connected into the circuit, what it means is we take it and replace it with a battery whose positive terminal is connected to the circuit, in which case that positive terminal will now go to the 18 ohm source, right? Then the negative terminal, we assume it is connected to the ground. So I'll pull it downwards so that you see that it connected to the ground. Then the 9 ohm, again, it's connected to the ground. The 15 ohm is connected to the ground. And the R4, the 10 ohm, I only label R4 now, is connected to the ground. So that is the next thing that you have to do. This is your 42 volt source. You replace it with a battery. If it is a negative, it means the negative terminal is the one which is connected to the circuit and the positive is grounded. If it is a positive, it means the positive terminal is connected to the circuit and the negative is grounded. So this is the next thing that you see in that circuit. Maybe if you can take a screenshot so that will be faster. Just take a screenshot and store that value. So you can see now that we have four ground points which are in the circuit. A ground is a common point. So we can connect all those four sources. So we connect the grounds. We connect the four ground sources. So now this is the new circuit that we have. All the grounds are connected. Now I'll reorient that circuit in the normal way that you are used to seeing your circuits. I'll reorient it so that it appears in the normal way that you see your circuits. So the new circuit now, we have the ground. Then from the ground, I go to the positive, to the negative terminal of the 42 volt source. Then I go to the positive terminal of the 42 volt source. Right? Then after that, I go to the 18 ohm resistance. After the 18 ohm resistance, it is connected to the 9 ohm resistor, which goes to the ground. And then the same point is also connected to the 24 volt source with a negative and a positive like that. And then the 24 volt is connected to two parallel resistances, which are also connected to the ground, the 15 ohm and the 10 ohm, which is our R4. Right, so that becomes our new circuit. I'll just show you everything. So that's the new circuit now. It's now in a normal circuit configuration. Right, it's now in a normal circuit configuration. Let me redraw that on another page so that we can move. Right, I'll be a bit fast, so just hold on. Put 2 volts. Excuse me. 18 ohms, 24 volts, 9 ohm, 15 ohm, this is the R4, which has got 10 ohms. Right, so from that circuit, this is what you what you get. From that circuit, this is what you get. Now, the next thing is we want to remove the sources and calculate their independent effects. We want to remove the sources and calculate their independent effects. Right. So I say, considering 42-volt source, I will show you what I'm writing here. So when I'm considering the 42-volt source, it means I'm removing the 24-volt source. So this is 42 volts. I have my 18 ohms. Now I replace the 24-volt source with a short circuit, right? Then I connect the other resistors as they appear in the circuit, and that's my RFO. So this is the new circuit when you consider the effect of the 42-volt source. That's the new circuit when you consider the effect of the 42-volt source. Now, the next thing is we want now to calculate the current through RFO due to the 42-volt source. So I call it I1. So my I1 now is the current pushed by the 42-volt source. Now, because my 42-volt source is pushing current in the clockwise direction, that means it will push current, it goes there, some branches there, the other one goes there, and it branches like that. So that is the movement of the current as it is being pushed by the 42-volt source. The next thing is how do I calculate that? I have to calculate the total resistance because I would want to use current division rule. So the total resistance, I will not show you the working. So it's 10 in parallel with 9 and 15, right? So 10 in parallel with 9, that's, it's not as straightforward as I thought. 15, that's product over sum, that's 150 over 25, right? For the first component. Then in parallel with the 9 ohm, so 150 over 25, that's 6, I think, should be 6 in parallel with 9, and then that will be in series with 18 ohms. So that will be equal to 6 in parallel with 9, that's 6 by 9, 54, 6 plus 9, that's 15. I'm correct. Then plus 18 ohms, that will be our sum. 15 into 54, leave it like that. You punch your calculators and see the value. But that's RT. You'll finish off on your own because I'm running out of time on my setting. So after that, RT becomes 54 over 15. Well, I don't have a calculator nearby. Let me just try to be fast because I'm running out of time. 15, come on. 54 divided by 15. 54 divided by 15. That's 3.6 plus 18. That gives us what? 21.6 ohms is the total resistance. Then the total current becomes equal to 42 over 21.6. Right, 42 divided by 21.6. I get my 1.944 amps. So the next thing, okay, let me show you this. So that the working that we have RT in parallel, that's 10 in parallel with 15, I got 6. then that is in parallel with nine, that is six in parallel with nine, and then that combination goes in series with that. Remember our series parallel networks, that's what we are using there. And our total current is 1.9444 amps, right? Then the next thing is to use current division. So the current through the 9 ohm, current into the set that we need, which is let's say I6. I6 now. So just add I6 to your diagram. We are interested in I6. We are able to finish. I6 now becomes equal to 9 over 6 multiplied by 1.944. No, 9 over 15, sorry. This should be the sum. 9 over 15. So 1.444 times 9 divided by 15. I'm getting 1.167 amps. You can now, you can verify I'm a bit in a rush. Then what we need is I1, which is current through R4 due to the 42 volt source. I1 becomes equal to 15 over 25 multiplied by 1.167 amps. So that's times 15 divided by 25. I get my 0.7 amps. That's I1 current into that source. So the current due to the 42 volt source is going downwards, and it is about 0.7 amps. Right, we are going into a break. Do the same procedure for the current produced by the 24 volt source. And I will need the solution when we come back. Okay, my time is running out. We take a break. Maybe a 10 minutes break, then we come back.